Greetings everyone, my name is Samir Hodžić and I am a postdoc student at Technical University of Denmark, DTU Compute section. In this talk, I'm going to present my work on quantum distinguishers for Type-3 Generalized Feistel network based on separability. The outline of the talk is given as follows, so we will start with the motivation, which is related to total partial breaks of certain block ciphers. Then we will give a brief overview of Simons and Grover's problems and related algorithms. Then we will point out a few constructions of quantum distinguishers for certain generalized Feistel networks. Then we will introduce the notion of separability, which actually tends to capture the main construction ideas related to quantum distinguishers for generalized Feistel networks. Then we will switch to quantum distinguishers for five-round Type-3 generalized Feistel network. And at the end, we will conclude the talk by recalling the main points related to the notion of separability. The attention of the community in quantum cryptanalysis of block ciphers has started in 2010 after the work of Avocado and Mori, in which they have applied the Simons algorithm for the first time in order to construct a quantum distinguisher for three-round Feistel network, which runs in polynomial time. This actually has been a motivation for evaluating the security of many other block ciphers. And the list that you see here on this slide is actually a short one, which provides enough motivation for continuing to reevaluate the security of other block ciphers, as we are considering the Type-3 generalized Feistel network in our work. Some of these algorithms are using just Simon's algorithm, but some of them are using actually the combination of Simon and Grover at the same time. Simons and, Grover's algorithms are used to solve the so-called Simons problem and Grover's problem. The first one, the Simons problem, is stated as follows. So we are observing a vectorial Boolean function f, which is defined on an n-binary vector space f2 to the n. And we are assuming that the function f is satisfying the following points. So we have that f in vector x is equal to f in vector y if and only if either the vectors x and y are equal, either they differ in vector s, a non-zero vector, and the problem here is to find the vector s. The Simons algorithm solves this problem in polynomial time, which actually depends on the number of input variables of the function f. On the other hand, we have the Grover's problem, which is stated as follows. So we are observing a function denoted by b with binary outputs, whose domain is set x, upon which we are not assuming any structure. And the problem is to find all inputs or all vectors in the set x at which the function b has value 1. The Grover's algorithm solves this problem in time O square root of cardinality of the set X. In all our work, in the place of the set X, we are using a binary vector space. Following the work of Avocado and Mori, the construction of quantum distinguisher for a three-round Feistel network, whose figure is given on this slide here, is actually based on observing the output branch Y1. Namely, the main idea for constructing the Simons function f is based on the following facts. First of all, the method for constructing f is the method of concatenating two functions, and here they are denoted by g and h. This means that we are going to query the encryption oracle quantum two times, where once we will actually, in the place of x1, input block, we will actually plug vector x meant to be a variable, and in the place of x0 we will be plugging the values alpha and beta. Assuming that the function f1 is invertible, then the requirement for alpha and beta will be that they are different vectors. And why we are using this construction? Well, first of all, we notice that the vector x is appearing only in the environment where the function f1 of alpha and beta are appearing. Also, we note that this construction here has the period given as 1s, where the vector s is f1 of alpha plus f1 of beta, which is a non-zero vector if alpha and beta are different and f1 an invertible function. So the main idea here, just to emphasize once again, is that we are doing a concatenation of two functions so that the relation between them is given in this form here. Namely, the function g and h here are given so that the h of x plus s is equal to g. And this is the main construction idea which we'll be using in our work as well. In addition, some other elements will be provided later on. Now, the main question here is whether the observation of just one branch is possible at all. Thanks to the work of Jose Amada and Sasaki in 2018, we have that truncation in the quantum environment is actually possible, and it has the same level of efficiency as evaluating the whole encryption function. Similarly, we have the quantum distinguisher for type 1 generalized Feistel network, which is without many details, it is given in this form here. And we see that the variable x is actually appearing only in this environment with the function h, where the function h is given in terms of the inner functions from previous rounds. One can use the same idea to construct the Simons function for type 2 generalized Feistel network. And in order to generalize these observations, we introduce the notion of separability. And we start with the following notation. First, by capital RF, we are denoting the output of the round function at round R in branch T. Then also we consider the representation of the input of the whole input of the encryption scheme, and we partition it into three blocks X, Y, and Z, such that we require that the length of the block X is at least 1. This requirement is just meant to be for the case when the block X is considered as a variable, while other blocks, for example Y or Z, can be of a zero length, in which case we are considering that they are not present. Now we have the following definition. So generalized Feistel network satisfies the song separability if the observed branch is represented in this way. Here we have the functions lambda, g, and h, such that lambda depends on y and z, as well as h depends on y and z, and the function g depends on the whole term x plus h of yz. And here we assume that the function lambda is a known function. Either it is a public function or it is a function which adversary may query it. In this context, it is important to observe the placement of blocks y, z, and x. Furthermore, we have the notion of semi-strong separability, and that happens if the observed branch has this for here, in which we have that variable y or block y is present outside of the function lambda, and we have also that the block z is present outside of the function h. And in addition, the function g depends on two terms, namely x plus hy and also z. And here we assume that the function lambda is not available. And finally, we have a weak separability if the observed branch has this form here, in which lambda depends on y and z. And the function g now depends on three terms, namely x plus hyz, and also g depends on y and z blocks. And here we assume that the lambda is eventually not available. We noted that the employment of only three blocks x, y, and z is sufficient to capture the descriptions of almost all generalized Feistel networks that we know. And as we will see in the following example, the description of functions lambda, g, and h, one can actually read from the expression of the observed branch. For example, if you are considering three-round Feistel network, say y1, then it has actually this form here, which corresponds to the strong separability property. We see that the function lambda here and function g and h are given in terms of inner functions, where just lambda function is an identity mapping. And regarding the input blocks, we have that the block x1 is labeled by x and x0 is labeled by y. Here the block z is not present because we do not need it, and we may consider it as a block of zero length. The main results related to semi-strong separability and strong separability are given with these two results, and they actually show that one can always construct a Simons function which has a period. One should recall here that the function lambda for one of these cases was not available, but due to the placement of input blocks, we are still able to construct the Simons function, which is periodic. Now, switching to Type-3 Generalized Feistel network and focusing only on four branches for simplicity, we have the round function given here. What one can notice that the fourth branch, which is given in this form here, satisfies the strong separability. This is due to the fact that the block X3 is not involved in the rest of this expression. And we simply can plug in the place of X3, we can label it as a block X, and the other blocks X0, X1, and X2 will be taken as a suitable constants. And in this way, we can easily construct the Simons function, which is a periodic function. However, if you switch to more rounds, say 5, then fourth branch at fifth round is given in this form. Other branches are maybe a little bit more complicated, but for some of them the ideas will be similar. Third, by observing the placement of blocks X0, X1, X2, and X3, we actually have that it does not satisfy neither the strong, neither the semi-strong separability. Now, the main idea here is actually to observe a term here in the whole expression, which has a potential to result in a periodic function f, and that term is x3 plus f3 of x2. This term is due to the fact that x3 is not involved into an evaluation of any inner function. For example, x2 is present in evaluation of the function f3, but x3 is not. So if we are choosing x3 to be the variable x and the other input blocks to be suitable constants, where we variate only the block x2, so we have this value b here, which is 0, sorry, then the form of the observed branch is given in this, then the observed branch is given in this form here. Here also we have in bold the terms which contain the vector x. The main problem here is actually that the vector alpha b2 is present also outside of the bold term, for example, here or here. And this is the reason why we are not having neither strong separability nor semi-strong separability. So in order to apply the same construction idea, that is the concatenation of two functions, we will be doing two queries. The first query will be the one which uses the input blocks x and alpha 0. Alpha 0, just to recall, is a triplet of three constant vectors. And the second function in the concatenation, we want it to be a function which is the same as the first one, but with shifted vector x with some unknown value s. However, in order to obtain this second function here to be actually a function which is obtainable by querying the encryption oracle, then we have this condition here, which has to hold for every vector x, where the alpha 1 is given as this triplet here. So now, by observing the whole expression of the fourth branch at the fifth round, we notice that this equality here, or this condition here, can be satisfied by observing a suitable system of equations. Namely, if we allow that the input blocks x0 and xy are taken as a variables, say, beta and gamma, then this condition here is actually satisfied if these two equality holds in some values of beta and gamma. So if this system here holds, then we actually have that the function f will be a periodic function, which means equivalently that the second function concatenation will be obtainable by querying the encryption oracle, and it will be obtained by querying it with values x and alpha 1. The observer of equations has a solution which is given in this form here, and it is possible if we assume that that the functions f1 and f2 are invertible mappings. So now, just to recall once again, the main idea here is actually that after assuming the invertibility of functions f1 and f2, we have that the observed system of equations will have a solution, and that solution pair will actually imply the periodicity of the function f, which equivalent to means that both two functions in the concatenation of the in the definition of the function f will actually be obtainable by querying the encryption oracle. Now, in order to find beta and gamma, which actually are not known due to the involvement of secret and round keys, we have to employ Simons and Grover's algorithm at the same time, and we will be doing that in the context of the Simon-Grover combination, which has been introduced in 2017 by Leander and May. And the main, just roughly describing the procedure, the main point will be that we employ the Grover's algorithm to find beta and gamma such that the observed system has a solution, and we are actually testing then the periodicity of the function f, which is actually related to Simon's algorithm. Now, in our follows, we provide more details regarding this Simon's and Grover combination. And more or less, this is the same algorithm used by Leander and May, which is just adopted to our scenario. So a precise definition of the function f in the context of all variables beta, gamma, b, and x is given in this form here. And in addition, we will be using the function c, which actually implements multiple times the function f, that we speed up the Simon's part of the algorithm. Then in addition, we'll be using the algorithm A, which starts with a zero quantum state, which produces then the quantum state phi. In addition, for the Grover's part, we'll be using the classifier B, which is defined in terms of two tests. Namely, the first one is checking whether the dimension of the span of measured vectors u1 to ul is equal to n. If it's not equal to n, then we will set that the value of the classifier and observed input has a value 0. And in that case, we are also computing the candidate period s prime. This vector s prime is actually orthogonal to measured vectors u1 to ul. Furthermore, we are in the second part of the definition checking the periodicity of the function n of the function f in terms of the variable y for sufficient number of vectors y. If all equalities hold, then the classifier at this input here will have a value 1, otherwise it will have a value 0. So for all inputs to the classifier b at which it has a value 1, they will be called good. If and only if, with very high probability, the input contains the vectors beta and gamma for which the observed system of equations will have a solution, and also in addition, the candidate period, just the period which we extract by using vectors u1 to ul, will actually be the one that we mentioned earlier. And this will happen with very high probability, as it will be mentioned in the next slide. To proceed further with the Grover's algorithm, we'll be also using the operator SP defined in this way, and also the operator Q, which is applied T times to the quantum state phi. Namely, this parameter T is related to the complexity time of the Grover's algorithm. And this is happening in the context of amplitude amplification algorithms, which is introduced in 2002 by Brasen. At the very end, after applying T times algorithm Q to the state phi, we will be able to measure a good state, which is also very close to 1. Just to recall once again, the good state will be a state which contains vectors beta and gamma, for which we have that the observed system of equations has a solution, and it will be actually a pair which also implies the periodicity of the function f, and the value s that we will be computing with very high probability, it will be this value here. So overall, the whole procedure here requires 2n plus l times 2n plus 1 qubits, where it's for l it is sufficient to take this value here. And regarding the quantum queries, we'll be having 2 to the n times o n, where the parameter n is the length of the branch. So to conclude this talk, we have this paper introduced the notion of separability. It is actually the property which can be observed for any generalized Feistel network. And we have seen that if we have strong separability or semi-strong separability, in those two cases, we are able to employ just Simon's algorithm in order to construct a quantum distinguisher. Otherwise, if we have the case of weak separability, then we have to employ the Simon-Grover combination, in which case we are focusing on two things. Namely, we are using the suitable construction of Simon function. In our case, it was a concatenation of two functions. And the second part was actually by observing collections, a suitable system of equations whose solvability will be important for constructing a quantum distinguisher for the observed generalized Feistel network. That's all. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for watching.